of you who might be visiting for the first time, or you just moved here, maybe you're watching for the first time online. We want to say welcome, and we want to invite you to be a part of our community of faith. And if you'd like to know more about who we are, you can simply scan this QR code and learn all kinds of tasty tidbits about who we are. And also, if you're moving and you're searching, if we aren't your speed, I've been in the Treasure Valley now, pastoring this church for on my 27th year, and I've gotten to know the scene, you might say, the spiritual scene of the valley. And if you let us know what you're looking for, we will help you find it, because our goal is to make sure that you're fully engaged in a local church. Now, we're in a series called Back on Track, and to jump into our study today, I thought I would take you down a little nostalgic path and see if any of you remember this song. Of the charts in the 80s. Wow. But it's a song, Welcome to Your Life. Here it is, your living life. And in the end, everybody wants to what? Rule the world. But the line in the song that I think is really good is he goes, I'm tired of this indecision married with a lack of vision. That is, we're living life, we're pursuing life, in one way or another, whether we admit it, we're pursuing happiness or pleasure, and yet there's a lack of vision and there's indecision in our lives. And so you might be thinking, what does this have to do with James chapter 4? Well, everything. You see, we want you to write your own personal spiritual growth plan for your life. Focusing on just this year, we've even developed a tool to help you do that. It's on our website. Our adult ministries department has been working really hard. You go through it. You know, it's interactive. You fill it out. You think, pray, do different things. Today, the step that they released this week in this tool is about clarifying your values. So as we jump into James chapter 4, the entire chapter is all about core values. So the main point of chapter 4 is this. If you want to grow strong in heart and mind, you need to clarify and align your core values with the values of Jesus. Now, we're going to jump into this and go through it. There's five major points that he makes that all focus around this issue of core values. And the first thing he does in the first four verses is he starts off by saying competing core values always creates chaos in your life. Here's another song that I really enjoyed to illustrate this point.
But today she met me at the door, said I would have to choose. If I hit that fishing hole today, she'd be packing all her things and she'd be gone by noon. Well, I'm gonna miss her. I get home.
I'm gonna miss her when I get home. That's called competing core values right there. Yeah, I thought I'd get you to laugh a little bit on it, because listen to these words, and he doesn't mince them in chapter 4, verse 1. He says, what causes fights and quarrels among you. And the word for fights and quarrels in the original language, he's talking about war between nations. He's not talking about a little hiccup. He's talking about massive fights and quarrels. He goes, don't they come from your desires? Everybody wants to what? Rule the world. Within you, you desire, but you don't have, so you kill. Now, most scholars who really understand James, written to Jews, believe that this is a statement defining what he talks about in verse 11 of the fourth chapter, where it talks about slandering one another. And in the earlier chapters, he talks about the tongue, right? And how it sets a forest afire and it destroys so many things. So it's an idiomatic expression. He's not saying they're actually going out there with a sword killing one another, but they're using their tongue and their words to try to destroy one another. He says, you covet, but you cannot get what you want. So you quarrel and you fight. You do not have because you do not ask. And when you do ask, you don't receive because you ask with the wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your own pleasures. You adulterous people. And what he means by adulterous here is it's not in a sexual context. It's in they're trying to be loyal to two separate kings or two separate leaders or two separate things in their life. He says, don't you know, and this is how we know that this is what he means, that friendship with the world, so they're trying to be loyal and follow the way of the world, he says, means enmity with God or against God. So he's saying there's these two different value systems, these two different core things that you're trying to be loyal to both. And he says they are diametrically opposed. You can't do anything. And as a wise old farmer said, when you straddle the fence, you only get splinters in one place. If you don't know your core values, there's chaos in your life. There's fighting and there's quarreling. This past week, I had the distinct pleasure on the Salty Pastor of having my son join me, and he made a really great point. And he said, you know, the whole theme of the book of James is in verses 2 through 4 of chapter 1, where it says, we encounter various trials, and we have to persevere. He said, oftentimes we interpret to think of, boy, I'm looking at all the circumstances that aren't going my way or difficulties I have to overcome. He goes, but when you actually read the book a lot, you realize that a lot of the trials and tribulations and the sufferings that we face are internal in nature. It's our own inside struggle in a lot of ways, you know, and having to work through that. And what happens is if you have no core values, if you don't know what your values are, they're not clear to you, if they're competing and you're trying to do multiple different things in different directions, then it's going to create all kinds of quarreling within your own self. C.S. Lewis says, if you don't know your core values, you are a man without a chest. You have no center. You have no driving code of honor. You remember the first Avengers movie where Agent Phil, you know, has had a fight with Loki and he lost. And he's sitting there and his last words to Loki are, you're going to lose. And Loki, the bad guy, says, how do you know? And he says, because you lack conviction. And that's so true in our world today, is that oftentimes we lose our own personal battles inside because we lack conviction. We're losing in the battle against what the world is trying to do to us because we lack conviction. You see, when our core values are unclear, when they're confused, they might even be corrupted. Guess what? Our lives lose focus. We lose our convictions. And this is one of the things that I think is so important about prayer. Notice what he says. You don't have because you don't ask. And when you ask, you don't receive because you ask with the wrong motives. You see, oftentimes people will say, why pray? You know, first off, if God already knows everything that's going to happen, then why pray, right? Somebody else says, well, I pray, and I, you know, God doesn't ever, you know, really follow through on my requests, or I don't hear him telling me anything. Well, the reason why is because the point of prayer is twofold. The primary point of prayer is that in the presence of God, you begin to uncover your core values in your heart. This is what David meant in the Psalms when he wrote, he says, "Search my heart, O God, and see if there is any wicked way within me." You know, even King David said, you know, I don't even know all the stuff swimming around in my own soul. I'm sure you don't either. I don't. You know, it's kind of like Paul in Romans 7 where he says, you know, sometimes I do things that I don't even understand why I do. Why do I do that? It's the opposite of what I actually value and want to do. So what prayer does is it helps you uncover the stuff that swims around down in there and clarify your core values. But the other thing that it does is so important is it aligns you with God's values. That's it. Now, one of the things that you'll notice is all along our campus here is along a main street or an artery into downtown Boise out into the sticks. And there's these high power transmission lines that run along it. And you'll see three lines always together because they transport it in high transmission lines through three phase. And what's really fascinating about this is if you're a lineman and you've learned to work on these things, is they teach you something very early on that will keep you alive. And that is this. Is the main lines, there's power running through them, right? And so the thing, though, that they teach you is that you have to be careful because if you have another line that you're working on, you're going to replace with, even though that wire is not connected to anything, it's not connected to a power source, not connected to anything, if it falls in parallel with one of those high transmission power lines, you know what happens to this line that's not connected to anything? It becomes charged with the same power. And if you touch it, guess what? Bad news. And so they say, don't assume that it's safe because it's not plugged in. So you always have to keep the wire parallel as much, or perpendicular as much as possible. Because as soon as it comes parallel, what happens? It becomes charged. When you are praying, what you're doing in you're aligning yourself with the values of Jesus. And when you align yourself with the values of Jesus, what happens is every part of your life starts to become empowered through the Holy Spirit. See, that's it. So if you're praying and you never hear anything at all, consider you might be a little perpendicular instead of parallel. Choose your P, perpendicular or parallel. And the reason why is because when our core values are unclear, guess what? It creates all kinds of conflict, especially with the people around us and internally. You need to know that when you write a spiritual growth plan for this next year for your life. Say, man, I need to write in my plan a way in which I can help myself come more in line with God's values so that I can start to see him working in me and through me more. See, that's important. Now, look at what he says next. It's really interesting as he says, guess what? If you start doing that, you're not actually doing it on your own, okay? Jesus is actually pulling you to him through the Holy Spirit because in his values, there's more grace, not less. Look at verse 5 and 6. Do you think Scripture says without reason that he jealously longs for the Spirit he has caused to dwell within us? Okay, listen to that. So when you come to Jesus Christ, you're redeemed by his blood. Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 1, that you receive the deposit or the kiss of the Holy Spirit. All right? Peter, on the day of Pentecost, when the church was birthed, he says, they say, what must we do to be saved? He said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So we receive the Holy Spirit inside. It's dwelling within us. I'm not the Holy Spirit. You may have a really great hair day, but you aren't the Holy Spirit either, right? There is, though, the Spirit of the living God, the Holy Spirit living within us, dwelling within us, and it says, God, Jesus Christ, jealously desires. So he's pulling us towards him. Do you remember a couple of weeks ago we were talking about how the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God? And we were like, what is the righteousness of God? Well, it is Jesus's work within you to conform you into his image. See, he's working on you and pulling you towards him. And so what's happening is he goes on to say, he gives us more grace. So when we're pulled to him, we receive more grace, not less. This is why the scripture says God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Now, it's really interesting because these words like humble and submission are all about aligning, getting in parallel with what God is doing, what Jesus Christ is trying to pull you towards. The values of Jesus have the goal for you to find your true self in him, your true authentic self, who you were meant to be in Christ. Now, we are on a path to try to find that. Our souls long for that. And oftentimes, we become friends with the world in order to discover that. But instead of having clear core values, they become more confused. Whereas Jesus is offering us more grace, and he's pulling us towards him to discover what is the good in life. That the good life is discovering the good in this life. And so he's saying, you, if you have pride, if you're friends with the world, what you're saying is, don't need you, I'll do it myself, right? Whereas if we're humble enough to say, I want to align myself with your values, I'm going to discover more grace. I'm going to discover more clarity. As a matter of fact, I'm going to discover my true, authentic self. Now let's go on and see what else he says next after this. In verses 7 through 10, he says something really interesting because he digs a little bit deeper about submitting and humility aligns you. And really the point is this, when we align ourselves with the values of Jesus, this is the only way to resist what the devil's trying to do to us. I mean, there's really power in these words. Listen to this. Submit yourselves to God. So that word submit doesn't mean, you know, subservience. In some cases, submit will mean that. In this case, what he's saying is you need to align yourself with Jesus, what he's doing, what his righteousness, his values, his core values, everything about Jesus' plan. Submit yourself to yourselves then to God. Resist the devil. So I'm going to resist the temptation to be friends with the world and do it that way, and he will flee from you. And then he reiterates it. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Now, if we go back, what does double-minded in chapter 1 mean? It's a guy who looks in the mirror, right? And then he walks away and forgets what he looks like. And so the point is that a double-minded person is like I said, a man with no chest. He doesn't know who he is. He has no code of honor. He has nothing. He's totally lost. And he's saying, look, you're double-minded. He goes, grieve, mourn, and wail. Change your laughter to mourning and your joy to gloom because you must humble yourselves before the Lord and he will lift you up. So this isn't an issue of subservience because I'm a pawn. What it is that he is the one who lifts me. He is the one who heals me. He is the one who restores me. He is the one doing his thing in me. But I will not experience it or live in it if I'm over here thinking, yeah, I don't need you right now. I'm doing my own thing. Okay? So he goes and says very specifically, you know how you can do this is number one, wash your hands. Wash your hands. So hands are very tactile. They're existential, meaning they're in this material world. He says, so basically stop doing things out of alignment with the values of Jesus. Stop your actions that are perpendicular to what he's doing. And then he says, purify your hearts. Now he's getting into your soul, into your inner world, right? And that means clarify your values. Clarify what you really believe and stand for in the kind of person that you want to become. This is why you need so desperately to have a spiritual growth plan. Because what it does is it shows you to yourself, this is where I need to kind of wash my hands a little bit of some of this stuff, and I need to purify my vision of who I want to become. And this is something that takes a long time. It's so important to realize that this growth and maturity in the Lord takes a really long time. It's not a 5-minute deal. It's not a 5-day deal or a 5-month year deal or even a 5-year deal. Just to kind of illustrate it a little bit is that I came here 27 years ago, and Foothills doesn't look anything like it looks now 27 years ago. And I met with the elders, and I said, look, if I come, I just want you to know I'm not going anywhere. I'm just going to be here. And 27 years later, I'm still here. And one of the things that I think is so important is that this is why community is so important. Small group, mentor relationships that last a long time, because we live in a world that is just friendly. It's not committed, right? And what happens is if something doesn't happen in 5 minutes or 5 days, we bounce along to something else. And we're like these bouncing balls all over the place. And then we wonder why we're not growing spiritually and becoming stronger, more courageous, confident people. Because you have to stay in one place in community over a long period of time. Right before COVID hit, I was talking to a man that I know, been a good friend for over 20 years, very successful both spiritually and in the world. Excellent businessman. And he was talking about how his story a little bit. And I, you know, because I've known him for so long, I know his story. He came out of an extremely dysfunctional situation, right? And so, you know, his motto was, my family dysfunctions are us. That was his kind of motto. But he has overcome all that. His story is, I didn't even go to church, knew anything about church, didn't know anything about God. And so I went to college and on campus ministry, started talking to me about Jesus and revealed, and I that's when I became a Christian. Went to college. And then he goes, you know, my journey has been really long. When I was in my 20s, I had 20 things in my life that created absolute chaos. There were things that I was doing that were totally out of alignment with the values of Jesus. But I was doing them even after I became a Christian. He says there was 20 things on that list. There were things like attitudes I had, beliefs I had, habits I had, addictions I had, all kinds of things. And these things just created utter chaos in my life. He goes, then in my 30s, guess what happened? He says, it got down to about 14 or 15 in my 30s, which was real growth for me, right? And he said, and then what happened is when I got into my 40s, I think is when I broke through the 10 barrier and got, you know, there's probably 9, maybe 10 things that created chaos in my life. He says, then when I got into my 50s, it got down to about 5. And he goes, in my 60s, you know, now it's about 2 or 3, probably 3. In my 70s, I hope I can get it down to 1 or 2. Of course, I'm like, man, this is a great trend. So what happens when you get to 0? He goes, well, then I think God is going to say you're done and I'm going home. So I want to get down to about 0.5 and then sit there for about 20 years and then go see the Lord. But what's really important to understand is that this is why community is so important, having roots. Because when you're in one place for a long time, you can grow over decades. In our men's ministry, one of our leaders who's really influential, he says, you know, I don't measure my spiritual growth in 1 month, 1 year, but I use decades. Eugene Peterson wrote a book where he said, the thing about spiritual growth is we don't understand that it's a long obedience in the same direction. It's a lifetime journey. And when you really think about it in light of eternity, it's kind of a drop in the bucket, so to speak. It's not much. So the whole issue is that when I align myself with the values of Jesus over a long period in my life, what's happening? I'm drawing near to God, and he's drawing near to me. And ultimately, in the end, I see I'm not a friend of the world. I am a friend of God. And I'm aligned with him in the way that I can say, wow, the power of God is within me. And I'm going to say something really controversial here, but it's the God's honest truth. And that is that churches in America have become so enamored with young youth and fresh. That the people who have followed God for decades and have the maturity and wisdom to know how to get to that point is lost because the church denigrates the elderly and the mature. And people go, well, why is the church so shallow? And I just go, duh. That's a thing I learned in seminary about. You see, aligning ourselves with the values of Jesus is only one way to truly resist the values of the devil. And sometimes it's better to follow in the footsteps of those who've kind of figured a few things out. Now, how do we know that we're adapting the values of Jesus? How do we know that we're on the right track? Well, he tells us in verses 11 and 12. He goes, here's how you know whether you're on the right track or not. Listen to what he says. Brothers and sisters, do not slander one another. Anyone who speaks against a brother or sister or judges them speaks against the law and judges it. When you judge the law, you're not keeping it, but you're sitting in judgment on it. There's only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and destroy. But you, who are you to judge your neighbor? So the word slander here is kata lalete. And what it means basically is speak ill of. So it's this notion of speaking ill of others. So how do you know that you're adopting God's values? How do you know that you're slowly growing from being a friend of the world to a friend of God? How do you know that you're slowly getting from perpendicular into parallel through prayer and what God is doing? It's directly proportional to how ill you talk of other people and how much you slander other people. Basically, it's how often do you blame other people for your problems? That's your clue. That's your gauge. I can't gauge it for you. Gauge it for yourself. You got to remember, these people were Jews. 100% of these people that read this early on were Jews. Okay? First, this was the first letter in the New Testament library written. And so many scholars believe it was written right before the council with Peter and the apostles and Paul and Barnabas. In Acts chapter 15. So what's happening is that these people were Jewish, and in Judaism, they had been trained to think in a way called legalistically. And that is, as long as I got to know the rules of the game, as long as I follow the rules, it doesn't matter what I feel or think. You know, I'm just following the rules of the game. This is why Jesus in Matthew chapter 5 said, you have heard that it's wrong to commit murder. That's the rule. I can't commit murder. But I say to you, if you call your brother a fool, you have committed the same offense against God. What he's saying is, this isn't about rule keeping. It never was. It's always about your heart. If you harbor hatred in your heart towards your brother, even though you haven't killed him, you're still guilty of the same thing. This is why in the Old Testament, I don't require or want sacrifices. I want a broken and contrite heart. Do you see how he's trying to point out that it's about our soul and the condition of our soul? And so what happens is Christians, oftentimes we come to know Jesus Christ. We're so thankful that we're in the band, that we get to show up. It's so awesome. And before long, we turn into legalism, just like the Jews are doing at this time. And notice that we start in grace and then we lose grace because we spend all of our time comparing ourselves with other people and then judging them. And he says, you can't do that. I mean, today in our world today, COVID is a perfect, perfect example of this. You know, there's people today at the church that are going back and forth. There's people that are saying, look, if you aren't wearing a mask, right, then you aren't following the values of Jesus, because he would wear a mask. And then you have other people say, well, if you're wearing a mask, you obviously don't trust God to protect you and you lack faith. And you have other people who are saying is that if you don't get a vaccine, then you are not loving your neighbor as yourself. When will you be your brother's keeper and get your vaccine? And then you have other people that say, well, if you get a vaccine, then you obviously aren't trusting God because he is your protector. You see, what the world wants to do is use that as an opportunity for people to judge one another. Foothills has always been different, and that's because I'm weird. But we've said, I'm not here to tell you what to think. What I am here to tell you to do is to align yourself with the values of Jesus, make really good, informed decisions for yourself and your family, and then be at peace and give grace to everyone else. You see, in our church, we have people who love hymns, you know, and they don't like Christian rap music. There's other people that love Christian rap music and don't like hymns. But the point of a community is that they come together, not in judgment, but in love. We have people who are recovering from alcoholism. They don't drink anything at all. And then we have other people who do drink. I'm often asked, what is our position on beer? And I said, the only policy that Foothills has on beer is that IPAs are overrated. Can I get an amen to that? But that's a humorous way of saying we don't really have one. See, if I tell you that the way you are going to align yourself with God is by following the values that I tell you you have to follow, what is that? That's called compliance. That's not called spiritual growth. And so what I'm asking you to do is don't draw near to me or a standard. Draw near to Jesus. Draw near to God. And the whole issue of vaxxed or unvaxxed or masked or not masked or this or that stuff, those things are not anywhere in the scriptures under any pretense a reason to judge and hate your brother or sister in the Lord. COVID is actually a wonderful opportunity. You know what it does? It gives us the opportunity to show grace and love for one another. So take that into account when you write your own personal spiritual growth plan, because if you can grow more gracious, then you're going to grow stronger with clear values. And then listen how he closes out. He says, not only should you continue to draw near to God, but in everything you do, verses 13 through 17, everything you do, you need to reinforce the values of Jesus in your life. Now, what I'm going to read to you real quick is what happened is Jews, as I said, they had this legalistic attitude, and that is, well, as long as I'm following the rules, I go do what I want. I just do what I want, right? And so what they were doing is they were making a whole bunch of plans without any attempt to include God in their plans, okay? Now listen to what he says very specifically. He goes, now listen, you who say, so he's calling specific people out in the church, today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business and make money. This is pretty specific. So what he's saying is that these guys had a specific plan. They were going to go out. They're going to make some money. He goes, but you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You're a mist that appears for a little while and then you vanish. So what is he saying? He's saying the whole point of your life is to align yourself with the values of Jesus. And if you think, well, as long as I got my, you know, heaven card punched, I'm going to go out and just do whatever I want. Craig Rochelle wrote a book called Christian Atheist that's about this topic. And that is that a lot of people say, well, I believe in Jesus. And then they live their lives as if Jesus doesn't exist, right? They never even take into account thinking or praying. And this is what he is addressing James. He goes, listen to what he says. He goes, instead, okay, what you're doing is friendship with the world. Instead, draw near to God. How do you do that? Well, you ought to say, if it is the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant scheme. So when I scheme and I don't have God in my plans, it's basically arrogance. Because I'm saying I don't need you, God. Got this one all on my own. He says, all such boasting is evil. I mean, what does evil mean? Oh, it's that black goo that's out there that gets on people. No, what he's saying is when you have friendship with the world and you're buying into your own values, you become confused. You can lose the sense of who you are, right? And he's saying that's enmity towards God. That's when anything that separates you from God and his values is evil. He says, if anyone then knows the good they ought to do and doesn't do it, it is sin unto them. So there you go. It's really easy. Go out and write a spiritual growth plan. Because when you do, what you're going to find is that you can draw near to God in an intentional way. And you can use everything you do as an opportunity to reinforce your new values. Oftentimes, you end up doing the same thing, right? But when God is there and he's a part of it, you can reinforce what he's doing in you. And that's the point. You see, strength is all about your core values. When you submit, you're aligning yourself. When you have humility, you're saying, God, you know better than me. When you purify, you're taking action steps. All to do what? Align your values with his. And there is a direct correlation, all research points this out, between clear, concise values and confidence in your life. Clear and concise values in Jesus Christ overcomes anxiety. It's the primary way to reduce anxiety in your life. When you have clear values and you know what they are, your self-respect grows and your sense of competency grows because you feel more competent. But the number one thing that having clear values in Jesus Christ does for your life, number one, research says, is it increases your joy. So don't miss out on the good life. Go to our website, download the tool to help you write your own personal spiritual growth plan. Because our hope as a church is that you will walk and live in the good life.
Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. What an incredible promise. Drawing near to God is much easier than you think. All you need to do is take one step. Maybe that's your spiritual growth plan for all of 2022, is to take just one step closer to Jesus. We are here to help you in any way we can. If you're watching at home after the final blessing, please take some time and do the discussion questions that appear on the screen. If you're on campus, please stand for closing prayer.
Jesus, you are the only winner. Amen.